Ladies and gentlemen, this is a regularly scheduled meeting of the Sunderland Board of Selectmen. If you can't hear me right now, it's because Lacey is slow on the button. No, she's shaking her head. No. We can call it to order at 6:36. We're a little delayed getting started tonight. We have two really important elements of the town, the fabric of the town, and that is the elementary school as well as the regional school. And tonight we're hearing from Superintendent Barrett as well as business manager Patty, who's going to keep us all honest with respect to their presentation. Members of the committee as well as members of the finance committee are here. And this is a follow-up and also kind of a lead. We met a week ago, had our initial conversation, and tonight it's out for what is effectively the annual towns districts meeting. There's a lot of them, four towns in a relatively tight window. So first of all, thanks for all the work. I really do appreciate it.
Oh, you're welcome.
So questions or comments before we plow into the Sunderland Elementary budget? That'll be the first one. Tom, you want anything?
I thought our job was to keep Patty honest.
She's got half the table already. She's ready to go.
She's got her coffee, so.
She's got to absolutely do it. She's got second hardest job in the room. With that said, thanks again so much for the work. If you want to go ahead and fire away.
So sure. Tonight, I'm looking at all of the budgets this year, not just for Sunderland, but for all four towns as more of a maintenance budget. We really have no new initiatives in any of the schools, and there are a couple of reasons for that. One of the biggest reasons in Sunderland is you have a very fluctuating population. So from last year to this year, you have a gain of about 40 students. However, when I look back at the census from the year before, you're only about 8 off of where you are now. So it seems to be an ever-changing, no rhyme or reason as to why that fluctuation occurs. Some may say because you have more transient housing. I'm not always sure of that. Having said that, so we have built into this budget, because it's a very high percentage increase right now, an additional classroom. We're keeping a very close eye. I checked on the numbers today to make sure nothing has changed. That could change. It could go down to one classroom and could be a reduction of a classroom teacher. The other things that are in flux right now is we do not have a negotiated contract as of yet. I'm hoping by the 1st of March that we will. So that number could also change. And one of the things that's changing for the town, but also changing for your portion of the high school budget, is that for the first time in 5 years, we have an increase in health insurance. So that went up to 6.8%. The other thing that you will see, I know we're going to talk about Frontier in a little bit. One of the biggest impacts, the number of teachers who are retiring there. So you will see that increase is driven by the contractual language for the sick leave buyback. Okay. So I'd also like to thank, because I know they've been out every single night, it seems like, for meetings with the new superintendent search. We have three school committee members, Michelle Tomlinson, Maisie Shaw, and our chair, Doug Fulton, are here tonight. They were over at the high school and then
rushed over
here. So I'm pleased that they're part of this. And just to also say, you know, to the public that's listening to this, they take their budget very seriously. They obviously want what's best for the school and the students, but they also live in town, and that they know that they're going to be on the front burner as far as getting questions. So I do expect that this number to change. And I'm hoping by the time we have our public hearing in March that we do have some different numbers. It really hasn't changed from when we met about a week and a half ago.
No.
So Patty can go over more of the details, because there are a couple other things that are driving this. So I guess we'll start with the elementary.
Okay, great.
Thanks, Patty.
Thank you for having us here. Sunderland is in a very odd position this year with our elementary schools. I know that we were notified back in December, maybe early January, that we are not going to meet our net school spending for FY16. And that because of that, the town should be contributing I want to get the correct number here, about $25,591 more to this year's school budget. I did call the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education, the head of finance there, and asked him if that meant I had to come back to the town and get that money appropriated. And he said, no, they can defer that to FY17. When we filed, I just want to explain why this happened. When we filed the end of the year report, part of that is called Schedule 19, and that's our forecast of our FY16 budget. When we filed that, with their estimates at that time of what our charter and choice kids were going to be, we met net school spending. December came, and they did the enrollments, the projected enrollments for charter and choice for 16, and we lost 14 kids. So the monies that you were paying towards charter and choice now have to come back to the elementary school. So at the end of 15, in June of 15, we had 18 kids out on school choice and 4 out in charter. As of December, we only had 8 out on choice and none out in charter. So those 14 children are back in our system or they're at Frontier now.
Oh, that so that's sense. A good news, bad news.
Right. So it's a calculation that looks at the potential outgoing.
Correct.
And yet when you look at it mid-year, essentially December, you have a population shift that's got to be corrected.
Correct.
Okay.
And they do that on October 1st, we have to file our census. And when the October 1st censuses were filed for FY16, that's when they saw that there was no charter students from Sunderland and that our choice had dropped by 10 students. So that makes us, with those tuitions deducted, we're short making our required net school spending.
Could I ask a question, if I could? If this was all charter going out, what would that aggregate be? We're talking about 26,000. We're a little short this year on what's essentially foundation budget, meaning people in students in our system. So if you were to take that value and have it be choice out, is that a greater value? That's on the state side.
20,000.
I can tell you that our final charter last year was a total of $37,653.
Yeah. So I'm trying to get that in a narrative that we can understand. Yeah, there's a little bit of an increase what I'm hearing in the base assessment, but we also didn't have those kids leave as was essentially projected.
It would have cost you more had those kids continued to charter out rather than come back in.
I appreciate that.
Okay.
Tom?
So if they were going to go out, we would have seen a reduction in the cherry sheet of $50,000. We would have been billed $50,000 for choice.
For choice?
$5,000 a student.
Mm-hmm. In lesser suspend differential.
Let me just pull up you would have
been. Exactly. Right. But it had been, so there are 10 students less in choice, so that would have been $50,000 going
out
to the other school.
Let's just say it was
straight. And then the charters, we have no idea. Charter could be anywhere from
14
to 20 something. More. So that could have been another $60,000. So
could have been. Yeah.
Potentially. So that could have been like that could have been right there. That could have been another. Theoretically, you're looking at potentially $100,000 we could have lost through.
Depending upon the configuration of charter and choice,
Right. So we're looking at the end of 15. The beginning 60, what you paid in FY15 for charter and choice was about $127,000. And right now, your estimate for FY16 is about $40,000.
Perfect.
So because of that.
Pretty good frontier math, huh?
Yeah, pretty good frontier math.
It's about 80,000, the number's $80,000.
Right, so because of that, $25,000 has to go back to the elementary school to meet the required net school spending. Okay. But as Mr. Sullivan said, you can defer that and make it up in FY17.
Got it.
So when we did our initial budget, we had our initial budget that we requested was $2,326,587, which then we had to add the $25,000. And then this year, our requested budget was also lower than this year's required net spending. So we had to go back and add some money. And we did not add that money willy-nilly. During our preliminary meetings with our principals, they list priorities of what they would like. So we went back and just took the two top priorities that didn't make it into the original budget and added that back. So having said all that, we want to start on page 1 of 17. This is what the Town of Sunderland Elementary School's foundation budget looks like. And right now they say our foundation budget per pupil should be $10,297. So if you take this and turn to page 2, they take, and that foundation budget is based on our enrollment, again, from the October census that we send in, what type of children that we have and what type of services. So we are up 6 students from 16. So the foundation budget is up $119,539. The required district contribution is up $60,617. And the Chapter 78 only went up $3,620. So we got $20 per pupil, which is the minimum you can get.
Now, is that, and I have to say, my inner cynic jumps right up and goes, is that the state's ability, defining our ability to pay based on prior years, really trend, complex math, and they go, well, you guys can pay for this. We just don't have to add any more money.
It is basically based on, when we get to page 3, about the community's ability to pay.
Okay.
So communities who have a lower ability to pay, they're seeing bigger increases in their Chapter 70 than we are.
Okay.
And that's most of your urban schools.
Tom?
All right. I thought I had pretty good comprehension skills, but I think I'm losing something as I'm aging. So the state is going to give us a grand total of $3,000 more.
Correct.
And they say we have to pay $60,000 more. I understand.
Correct.
Come on, Marty.
Look at it this way, Tom.
Come on, this is an amazing. These are amazing statements.
Oh, they are amazing statements.
I'm only repeating.
I wonder if we should. You know, what would be amazing to me if we put our if we brought our elected legislative representatives into this meeting and sit next to our residents, so they could hear what we had. And I wonder if they would just sit there and go, what's wrong with this?
Well, I don't disagree with anything you've said.
I know you don't. I know you don't. I just think it's an amazing thing. They really, Scott, I don't know who's going to be sitting in these seats next year, but can we make a point to when the Frontier School Committees and Superintendent and Business Manager come to make their presentation, can we invite our elected representative to sit in a meeting with us?
Sure.
All right, they got to hear this stuff. Because we're not making it up. They always ask us questions, and we tell them, but they never seem to get it.
I don't understand. They're the ones making the rules, so I don't understand how they don't get it.
Yeah, I don't think they're making the rules. I think somebody's making the rules.
Right. No, you raise a good point about the system.
Yeah, what they're saying is, the good news is you're keeping more of your students in district, because we would have sent you a separate bill.
Right.
Right, for the outcome.
We would have sent you a separate bill.
Simply would have been gone off of the sheet.
Wouldn't have been part of your school committee budget.
Yep.
So you got to look at it from that. I'm sure that's what they would say.
I know.
It's a measure of doing
it. And by the way, we're going to give you $3,000.
Right.
I just think that's
for all your good work.
For all your good work.
Retaining those students, here's
that's
a
right.
Nice big check.
So if you take our required district contribution of the $1,501,316, which is in the right-hand column marked FY17, add that to the Chapter 78 of $849,283. The required net school spending is $2,355,99. That's the least amount of money we can pay towards the elementary education in the Town of Sunderland. So if you go to the next page, this is where we get the computation on the Town of Sunderland's ability to pay. So on the left, they show that the equalized property value is $351,627,700. The property percentage they're using is 0.3792, which means the local effort from property wealth would be $1,333,283. Now they're still using the income from the Department of Revenue from 2013,
yeah.
And hopefully next year they'll get us to 2014. So what they do there, they get the information from the Department of Revenue, and everyone who filed an income tax with the zip code that belongs to the town of Sunderland, and they're saying that was 9956. And then they apply that income percentage, and that the local effort from income is $1,337,121.
So, Patty, if I could interrupt, is part of their formula to suggest their baseline is the 2013 taxed income, mm-hmm. the filed income for an individual or a household?
Gross income from tax return. So it would be if you however you
qualify. Got it. Okay. So 90,956 was the 2013 base in or means income
in the town
in the town. Okay.
So you add those two numbers together and you get 2,670,404. Now our foundation budget is 3,362,204. They take 82.5% of that and say that it's 2,773,819. Because since 1993, with education reform, that's they're trying to get to everybody that they would be paying 82.5%.
So formulaically, they're trying to drive the local contribution in support of education to that 82.5. Okay.
Right.
So across the Commonwealth now.
Yes.
So that eight can't. So where did that eight number come from? Because
the row eight comes from page one. Actually, the foundation budget for FY17 would be all the districts that the town of Sunderland belongs to. So it's not just the elementary,
okay.
It's Frontier Regional and Franklin County Tech. So it's the three combined because okay. the town of Sunderland is a member of all three.
Right, it's our 1.86 plus this one.
So the 82.5 is aggregate education, not just elementary, not just Frontier. Got it.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead, Bruce.
On row four, the 2013 income, is that supposed to be 90,000 or 90 million?
90 million.
That's the total income that everybody made.
Reported
income.
Okay.
Maybe not what they really made, but that's what's reported.
what they made. Yeah.
Conflicting number.
Well, that's an interesting number because I looked at some numbers for communities in Franklin County. In Sunderland, the other three towns in our district averaged out in excess of $75,000 per household. Sunderland was $50,000 average salaries.
Do you know what was interesting? A couple years, maybe 2 years ago, they had an article in Mass Live, where do the millionaires in Massachusetts live?
And Bruce. No, not me, Tom. That's for sure.
And we're looking for the answer, Bruce. It wasn't an assertion.
Waitley and Leverett.
And of our four towns, Waitley and Sunderland had the most millionaires.
That's you, Tom.
If you're talking Italian lira, you are correct. You are correct.
Lira?
Or lira.
Lira went away years ago. Actually,
if you're talking
about the Japanese zero base, so you're really in trouble there.
Yeah, Japanese yen, okay? Because I think it's like 770 yen per dollar or something like that. So
1.4 pounds to the dollar.
Is it what now?
110-ish, 120.
Is it?
Per dollar, yeah.
So if we take the 82.5%
better way back when I was traveling.
Of the foundation budget, they're saying we should be at 2,773,819. So then we take the lower of 7, which is 2.670,404, and the 2,773. So we take the less of the number. So technically, we should be at 82.5. We're at 79.42.
Yep.
So that's why you see your minimum contribution increasing every year. So now if we go over to the right, now they're saying we're going to give you increments to that goal. So they're trying to get everybody equal. And prior to the financial crisis, they had a five-year plan, mm-hmm. And it sort of just went by the wayside because everybody tanked.
Right.
So what they're doing now is they take your required local contribution from this year, which was $2,728,964. They take your municipal growth factor, which they have is 2.49%. And that is found on the information, Sherry, I forget what you called it, that you guys have to file every year.
Schedule
those,
A.
And those schedules.
Schedule A. Yeah,
schedule
the recap.
A. That's where that comes from. So the preliminary would be 2796915, which would put us at 83.19%, which is over the 82.5%. So they take the excess local effort, which would be line 15 minus our line 10, and it's 126,511. They're trying to make it 70% towards the target, which is 88,558. So the required local contribution capped at 90%, which is line 15 minus line 18, and the minimum contribution is $2,708,357. Now again, if you flip back to page 2, you'll see that the minimum contribution here is $1,005,000. That's the part that is allocated to Sunderland Elementary. The other pieces are allocated to Frontier and to Franklin County.
So we don't have to include the money that we're spending on a student that we're sending on tuition to Smith Vocational?
No, because you're not a member of Smith Vocational.
So although he's going to school,
you're still paying.
But it doesn't count.
Formula, right?
Right.
Oh, of course.
Right. You just have to pay the full amount.
Right.
Plus transportation.
Right.
Right. But it just doesn't count.
It doesn't, no.
Against your budget, it does, but it does. Not in the formula. No.
The appropriation.
Not here because
I'm just being facetious right now. I just don't understand how you do this kind of stuff.
But we do everything we can to keep them at Franklin Tech. The only one that can go to Smith is that what's called Smith? Mm-hmm. Is our students who are in a program that isn't offered by Franklin County Tech.
Right.
And then once they're there, our superintendent gets reports quarterly on their attendance that they haven't switched shops. Because if they switch shops,
common shop,
they come back.
Yeah, smart.
So we do keep an eye on them.
Mm-hmm. Oh, not my concern was they were still paying for that child's education. Yeah. So why wouldn't it count?
Well, it's part of the formula. It would be really dynamic. I mean,
you were not part of
year.
The original agreement and invited to be part of it years ago.
But it is reported on the end of the year report as tuitions to other Mass schools. I get those numbers from the administrators, and I do report them on the end of the year report.
I have to say, first of all, I appreciate the framework this is all under, but it feels tragically a lot like someone who's filled out FAFSA forms for the last 8 years.
Yeah.
It feels a lot like a statewide FAFSA form. Here's what you can pay, and here's what you're going to pay.
Now, part of it, one good thing that I think that we can look at this is that they did have a foundation budget commission who went throughout the entire state and, in fact, held, I believe, 2 meetings in Western Mass when usually they ignore us.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to the one that was held in Northampton. And it was very interesting because how the foundation formula affects Franklin County, because it's more of a farming community, they were awestruck because there were so many people there from these farm towns saying this is what happens, and a large part of the foundation budget is the extra monies that you get when someone is a special education student.
Mm-hmm.
And they are really looking at that. And the second thing that they're really looking at is how the cost of health insurance is affecting the school budgets. So those were their 2 big takeaways, that the rising health insurance costs are really killing school budgets, and we're having to do without in order to provide benefits. And they're looking, you get a certain amount of money if a student is a SPED student, and it's the same amount of money whether the child's getting speech services or they're out of district.
Mm-hmm.
Which does not make sense. And because of that, that's why they started the circuit breaker program. So now, if they're changing the way we do the foundation budget, we may see the circuit breaker program go away, but that would be okay because now we're more in line with what a special education student is costing us based on their IEP.
Interesting.
So now they did that, and they had a report. What's happening with it now? I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean that, so there is a little bit of good news that they recognize that the found, there are issues in the foundation budget itself.
Questions, Finance Committee, while we get through the theory about how we got here? Okay. Thanks, Patty. Okay. Appreciate it.
So if you look on page 417, that does give you your breakdown for the three schools that you support with your foundation budget, your enrollment, and how your local contribution, your minimum required contribution is broken out between the three schools that you participate in.
I got a question.
Go ahead, Bruce.
What's the enrollment of Sunderland Elementary right now?
Right now, are we at
231.
231? And out of that 231, how many are choice?
How many are choice? I think we have about 40-some students.
We had 46 at the end of last year.
So that's about 186, yeah. 85 residents.
Yeah.
Okay. Actually, Bruce, hold on.
We got right here. The numbers, yeah.
Pages, I think it's toward the end of the report.
Yeah.
Foundation enrollment for this year is 175. FY16.
Okay, the foundation enrollment is residents.
Yes.
Correct.
Okay, yes. Okay.
As of December, we had 40 children coming in.
Okay.
40 school choice okay. students coming in. Estimated to give us $253,559 in revenue.
Okay.
Okay.
So, Doug, how many school choice kids were going out 7-8 years ago?
You lost about 50.
50.
Students. Yeah. And I think that's why you saw that shift mm-hmm. of students.
I just. Choice. And again, When we back had our discussions back, we talked about the effect of a failed override, and it was one of the things was that we would lose children to school choice, mm-hmm. and I think some people that had a big tractor trailer truck with a sign on it didn't believe that they'd actually lose school choice kids, but when you lost 50 children, we were losing 50 kids, mm-hmm. and that cost the town about $250,000 outgoing dollars. Today we have zero school choice. Mm-hmm. No, charter.
Zero charter.
We have eight school choice and we have 40, so we have a net 35 coming in.
Right.
So comment I would like to make is that if you go back in history and discuss fact, cutting school budget ended up with a very sizable outgo of money mm-hmm. through school choice.
And it took you
seven years
to get back. I would say this is the first year that you're seeing back to right. where it should be.
And so I think that's, and even though it wasn't here, I think what we're all saying is very true. You had a failed override, services and programs were cut. Mm-hmm. Over the next few years, we've been, with the support of the select board, we've been able to, and the school choice monies that we've been bringing in, we've been able to bring those programs back,
right.
and our kids are staying.
No, I was just trying to make a point, because yeah. sometimes we forget.
All right, we've actually got the data to back up the assertion.
Well, we didn't have the data, and mm-hmm. we were told that we were making things up. Right. There's no proof that exactly. we were told that there's no proof to what we were saying.
Sure. We did, you know, even though I wasn't superintendent then, I remember there were exit interviews done. Why are you Absolutely. Choosing to go to Waitley, to Deerfield, to Conway, to Hatfield? A lot went to Hatfield. Yeah. And then their Amherst. Siblings followed. But now that they've sort of graduated out, the families that you have in town are choosing to stay in town because they should. Offer the same things that every other school is offering.
Right.
And that's why the school committee, you know, is very cautious about areas that they would want to cut because we don't want to repeat that, what happened 7-8 years ago.
And of the 8 children going out, only 2 are going to another town in the union.
Mm-hmm. So that ones are probably convenience.
Exactly.
It's okay. I like to revisit history.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Heston and Mr. Barner. Very good instructors.
They were very good history teachers.
They let me know that history repeats itself. So,
mm-hmm.
okay.
So running with that thread, if I could, if you were to look at 2009 versus 2017, we're only a plus of 139,401 in what's essentially the eighth budget year.
I don't know what you're
referring. I'm looking at town budgets.
Okay.
We started in 2009 with a budget of $2.169 million.
Yeah, one of the things that, and you don't have that information there. We keep stuff. We like to go back and look at our budgets long term.
And that was even before. So and we did lose. Obviously, as we were just saying, we did lose and paid a lot of pain.
Well, you know the sad. Go ahead.
But you know, if we go back to the budget before that, I think it was like 2.3 in the enrollment. Was about where we are now. I can't say 100% in terms of buildings and choices. But I think the choice on balance was comparable then before that. So the big cuts as it is now, and I mean, if you add inflation onto that budget, I don't know if that was the perfect budget, but anyway, we're talking numbers that are probably less than what we're presenting today. So it looks like a big increase today, but the fact is our enrollment has gone back up.
Sure.
Over the past, several years.
That's right. And people at town meeting may lose sight of the fact that people who participate in town meeting, and thankfully they do, everybody who goes, I appreciate them. I think it's primal democracy. It's wonderful stuff. However, that choice outgoing formula, you don't get to vote on that.
Yeah, right. You don't.
There's no voting on it. When those kids leave, so goes your money. Anyway, sorry,
choice.
Enough.
Choice. So 5 or 17, what I've done here is, this is sort of for our school committee.
What page are you on now?
5 of 17. So what I did for our school committee was because I had given them a draft budget already. So some of these numbers you've seen before. So the required district contribution is $1,005,1316. Yeah, the Chapter 78 of 849. So our required net spending was $2,355,99. We have the carryover of the 25,591, which now makes our FY17 net school spending requirement to be $2,376,190. The budget draft number one was a request of $2,326,587. So we had a shortfall again of $49,603. And that's what we added back to get to the budget that we are presenting in draft number two.
So, Patty, if I could, you developed the team got together, developed a budget of 2.37. I'm sorry. Yeah, 2.326. And then the formula injected the revenues, mm-hmm. and then a subsequent conversation revisited where the priorities were.
Right.
Okay. Thank you.
So now page 6 of 17 is the summary of where we were last year, what's changed, and where we are now.
So I got a question.
Yes, sir.
In the past, hasn't the elementary school turned money back to the town?
Very little.
But they have.
The money we turn back, right? Is the difference between what we, at the end of the year, what we have POs out for, and then what we actually spend. Yeah.
Well, no. I understand. I'm still going to dip. So, but you have turned money back to the town before because you guys have been fiscally responsible in how you spent your money.
Mm-hmm.
How's that? So how was that? How did that affect your net school spending?
We were always okay because we had because of the amount of charter choice going out.
Right. So that's where the fluctuation occurred. I know where you're going with that, Tom. If you had a few thousand bucks that you turned back to the town, how can that, wasn't it caught?
Right.
It's because you had 14 kids going out.
Okay.
And that kept the formula in balance.
Okay.
In one year, and the year prior to that, you had more kids going out. So every year we've been decreasing the charter and choice out numbers.
No, I was just going to ask. I was just going to ask why don't we just make an appropriation out of stabilization or free cash?
Pay for the one time.
Pay the one time.
Right. Interesting point. As we develop our strategy, right?
Well, you do it one time, and then it takes it.
I guess I'm not following you. You would like to make an appropriation of the $25,000 to the 16 budget rather than rolling it over to the 17?
Potentially.
Okay. That would be your prerogative.
Well, I'm just thinking about, I mean, if you were short on something.
Right. Just cover the shortage, essentially.
I don't think we're going to be... I think right now our budget is good. We're coming in. I believe the two areas that we changed were technology, but there's nothing to say we couldn't buy that technology this year instead of FY17.
Right.
But if you wanted to keep your money earning interest and not give us from free cash the $25,000, you'd hold on to that money till we presented those bills in FY17. So your money would be earning interest for you longer if you didn't do that.
I think you could do it either way.
Right.
Well, I'm just thinking, I hate, personally, one of the things I don't like when you do a budget, if you add money to a budget that's a one-time, that's a one-time addition, then you set the bar to a certain level that you're going to repeat so that you're perpetuating, so it's better. So if you do it outside of the budget process... Mm-hmm.
But it's going to keep repeating every year
because
anyways,
of your foundation.
Because of the formula. And the
of course, the foundation.
So it's not like it's a one-time piece they're letting us catch up on. But every year, our required net school spending is going to increase.
As long as you keep maintaining your students.
Right.
Yeah.
So.
And of course,
and
you didn't need it in the budget.
Keep coming down.
That's what I'm saying, maintaining the students.
Right. All right.
Okay. So now
You thought this was going to be easy, didn't you?
No, but how much time do we have? I do.
Five minutes. More to go through, right?
We have 5 minutes?
Yeah, 5 minutes.
To do Frontier 2?
Yeah.
Okay.
15 for Frontier.
I'll talk faster. Okay, so on 6 of 17, this is the summary that tells us where we started from last year's budget and where we're going to end up this year. So although we do not have a negotiated contract, we still honor the collective bargaining steps, which will add $10,479 to the budget. We have teachers who have earned new degrees, and that means they change columns on the matrix, and that will be an addition of $3,323. We have one employee who has now achieved longevity, which adds $250 to the budget. Mr. Barshevsky is looking to increase his physical education. And I should have the FTE there, and I don't, I apologize. But the increase in time would be the $10,875. We were really tight with our PE, with our regular enrollment. Now with the additional, it's almost impossible to do it. We're combining too many classes.
So if we add another classroom, we will need to add another portion of the PE.
That makes sense. It's spreading across the population.
Yeah. Right.
We do have an increase for an instructional assistant. That looks like it's 1.5 of $45,092. And what happens with this is when we come to you at this time of the year and we have our budgets, by the time we finish the end of the year, we had another instructional assistant that was required by an IEP. So this person was hired in FY15, just not budgeted for. So we have to now budget them in FY16.
Okay.
The cost for the additional first grade teacher, we're averaging it at a master's 5 level, because that is our average education level and experience level. So that would be $54,377. We have an increase for insurances, retirements, and contracts of $42,732. And when I say insurances here, this is the piece of the cost of the insurance for the central office folks that you fund. So it's their piece of the benefits that you pay through the formula. And we do have one retirement. And then we do have an allowance in here for contract negotiations, both union and non-union. But we can't discuss it any more than that because it would be an unfair labor practice. So that is the amount we're putting there. One of the things we do want to do this year is raise our sub rate from $65 a day to $75. We are the lowest in the county, and we have difficulty getting subs because everyone now is using this ASOP, and so they go on and they shop. Mm-hmm. So if they see a job that's going to pay $75, they're going to take that. Mm-hmm. So we get we have a lot of days where we have sub shortage.
It's also dangerously close to the minimum wage, so $65.
That's a daily rate.
Correct. The daily rate, yes.
It costs you more to hire a babysitter that does a substitute.
I know.
Which is not right.
I know. It hasn't been increased in probably 10 years, so it's way overdue.
So other operational increases we have, due to students that require special ed services inside the school building, that is increasing by $1,000. We are looking for $5,000 to update our literacy closets in the social studies and science areas. The Chromebooks would be $19,012. Summer instructional services. 3 years ago now, we had instituted the Horizons program at Sunderland Elementary, and those students require a full year educational program so that there's no regression in the summer. And during the first two pilot years, we had a grant that was covering that, and now we can no longer, the grant can no longer support that. So we need $18,000 to keep those services going through the summer.
Is that a discretionary program or required?
It's required.
It's required, and we used to have to find out of district.
You keep asking the same questions.
That's fine.
No, that's okay. Yeah. It'd be more if we had to send them out to an out-of-district placement for the summer.
Okay.
You also did have an increase in the central office percentage. You went from 2167 to 2495. And again, that's because of your increased population. And that totaled about 5,550. Miscellaneous maintenance accounts, we adjusted by $875. And then we did have a decrease in our school committee legal expense of $1,500. And that's because we did hire new attorney, and they gave us a 3-year contract, this being the last year. So even though we're deducting it this year, we may be looking at an increase because this would be the end of the third year.
That's just sales. Yeah. That's all it is.
Well, we have wonderful attorneys. So.
That's good.
Pages 7 of 17 through pages 15 of 17 is just the detail, the line item detail. And I will leave you to look at that.
Yep.
I do want to point out that on page 15 of 17, under where it says FY16, our percent increase was only 2.5% last year.
Over 16 over 15, Patty, right?
Right.
Got it.
On page
15
of 17.
17.
It's down the bottom there.
Before we plow through these, you're right, we'll take that as homework because we have another budget to go through. But I would like to ask one question of the school committee members intimately involved with the budget process. And thank you for all the time in doing that. Are there any areas of impact that will show up in 17 that we anticipate surprises for? 10% is a big nut in 1 year.
Right. Is there other...
Are there anything programmatic, anything organic, anything we make an increase this year that suddenly comes up next year? You know, we have this rolling average, and I'm not picking on the library, but the state says, hey, every year you put a little bit more money in, the next year you're really kind of required. I'm sorry if I'm mischaracterizing it, trustees, but, you know, your ability to pay again.
Right.
So.
Well, I don't think it affects, you could speak to the foundation better than I could, or the
minimum contribution.
Yeah, but I do know, and again, could get into the details, but I mean, we pushed what we spent out of choice in the FY16 budget to try to keep that down. We talked about that in the last meeting. And, you know, that's not sustainable over time.
Right.
We can't, I mean, you know, we are spending it a year in arrears, so that gives us some flexibility in a crunch year. But if we can continue to do that, at some point we cut it too close and we're in trouble. So
that's that is this year.
Yeah.
Not continue to do that.
Right. So the other piece I would like you to keep in mind is I really think we should have full day preschool programs.
Mm-hmm.
That would require quite a bit of an investment, not only in space, but in personnel. One of the things that we are seeing statewide, countywide, district-wide, is a huge increase in needs of our 3- and 4-year-olds coming in.
Okay.
And We did increase Deerfield programs this year, so we have 3 full-day programs. I think Sunderland would be the next target for that. We have talked to the school committee. So that would be something that I would hope a planning session or committee would take place this year.
Do you have this visioning exercise that says it could look like this?
Yes.
This is an enrollment-based?
Yes.
And it's a volunteer enrollment. And does it include out-of-district or?
It's volunteer. It's voluntary. So there would be tuition-paying students. Mm-hmm. But any child that comes to us with needs, there would be no tuition because we have to service them a minimum amount of hours.
Yep.
So those hours would be free for those students. If they stayed after the required IEP hours, there would be also tuition. Okay. That account already pays for about $20,000 of our EC teacher. But we have an excellent early childhood coordinator in Ms. Kimberly McCarthy, and she has done wonders turning the Deerfield program around, and we're seeing a lot of success there, and we're seeing the growing need in Sunderland.
Okay.
Some of the things I also want to add is that, again, we don't have a collective bargaining. That's going to affect next year.
Sure, sure.
We also have a technology director who has done an extremely detailed inventory of all 5 schools and what they have, and he's looking, and we didn't ask for it this year, he's looking for about to replace 1/5 every year.
Yep.
So that would require on Sunderland's part about $20,000. So because when he arrived here, everything was falling apart. Our technology was being held together with paper clips and rubber bands. And we were able to use funds at the end of 1 year where we had some savings to upgrade the servers. And now he wants to make sure we maintain that schedule of changing the servers, the switches.
Sure.
And we're also getting more and more into the one-to-one device for our students.
Mm-hmm.
And then the last thing I'll say is, you know, superintendent this year has not done any new programs or initiatives because we knew the money's tight. Mm-hmm. But we're going to have a new superintendent. There is a need. I mean, if we want to keep progressing, we're going to need to, you know, invest in more curriculum materials and things, new programs to keep our schools at the level 2 that we are at, so that we continue to be successful.
Curriculum wise, I think we're okay.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what the results of the Long Range Planning Committee study will be, but I think that's something that would affect all 4 of the towns, depending upon
district-wide initiatives.
Could be.
Yeah.
Could be.
Okay.
I think one of the things, especially with the technologies, I'm sure we're going to need a lot of stuff, but I think that's something that we need to look at leasing, like corporations do.
He does. Because, we're in a leasing program.
Good. And keep
he,
it.
Yeah. He has a 5-year plan. This was supposed to be year 1 for funding it, and we were not able to do it in any of the budgets.
So right now we have one or two leases at Sunderland for computing devices. Yeah. The money here for 19 will be able to expand our leases for more classrooms to have the one-to-one devices, so that they're not on carts, that each classroom would have their own one-to-one devices. Yep. And that's what we would be doing. But again, it's a lease, and that's why we'd be looking for $20,000 every year, so that every 3 years we're refreshing our
equipment. Because it should be essentially an ongoing budget expense.
Exactly.
Yeah. That thing. You know about it, it's a fixed cost, and it's easier to manage.
But on the flip side, at some point, we should be able also to reduce our textbook line, because we're really not purchasing the textbooks.
In theory,
so we should see, you know, and of course our textbook line is nowhere near the technology cost, but it would be some savings, because we would be encouraging our principals to look at that very closely and say, do you really need this, or is it something that we can buy an app for?
That's all right.
All right. So those are the details. And then page 16 is our other funding sources. So, as we just talked about, our early childhood tuitions would pay about $20,000 of our preschool teacher salary. Title I would pay about $12,001 for our reading specialists. Our SPED revolving for the Horizons program will fund about $70,310 in salaries, because that program, we do have some out-of-district tuitions coming in.
Okay.
And then the 94-142, which is the federal grant, would pay about $78,275. Below that, we look at our school choice projection. We're looking to be in the hole at the end of this year, about $114,265.
Now, it's not a negative cash balance because we had always spent a year in arrears.
Yeah, right.
Against that.
Okay, against,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah, 2016.
And the reason this error happened is because when we got our school choice projected income mm-hmm. last December, which is what we based our budget on, it included two children that go to the Horizons program, but they're actually school choice in Deerfield.
Got it.
So they accidentally put our money there, and in June they corrected it, so we didn't get the money we were supposed to get. And to keep our budget at the 2.5 increase, we had put more staff there. So this year our income is projected to be 253. So we hold that same number to be true in 17. So okay. We would have $392,000 to spend this year, and this is what we have projected to use it, which leaves us $9,921, which isn't much of a cushion,
right.
But that's the money that we usually do, that we usually like to keep in case we do have a new move-in that is an expensive spend. So we are no longer spending the school choice a year in arrears. We are now going to be spending. So next year, this budget has to be decreased significantly, and these are not ancillary expenses. They're required to run the programs that we're using. This is our art, this is our music, this is our Spanish. So if you're asking for budget busters, mm-hmm. you're looking at the difference of 253 and 382. We'll, unfortunately.
Yeah.
So that's why I brought that up. I brought it up a couple times. So
a lot there. No, I appreciate that.
Yeah.
Okay, and then the last page is just the distribution of the percentages for the superintendent's office and the Frontier and the four school union percentage.
And this page is consistent with the Frontier budget as well. This
yes.
is our gross percentages
yes.
across the district as well.
Yes.
Questions before we move on or off of? Go ahead.
So we've gone to start using a school choice in the next year for this year to pay off the,
mm-hmm.
the like
it's the next year. This I mean it's kind of it's earlier than we normally would because mm-hmm. it's normally like a full year behind where we spend it.
But it's because the town of Sunderland has asked us to keep our percentages to 2%, 2.5%. So the only thing we could do would use the school choice money so that we wouldn't have to cut services and programs in school.
I will say, unfortunately or fortunately, we did that pretty much throughout the district last year with the budget. So we did keep our budgets low, but it was taking the school choice dollars. So it's almost artificially
right.
lowering the
right.
budgets.
Last year it wasn't quite right. We were more aggressive. I mean, we've been pretty conservative about that.
Mm-hmm.
It's been reason. So I think in that 09 or whatever budget, we were aggressive and last year, but otherwise we tried to not put ourselves in a position. Because, you know, if the demographics change and all of a sudden we're not trying to fill classrooms, because that's where we're doing choices, where we see we're going to have two classrooms, and now we're, rather than have do it 13 or, you know, 14 or something like that, you know, then we will take some choice, you know, not in those situations and take that revenue. But if that
Excuse
changes
me.
And now we're like, okay, we're only going to have the one classroom and you know, that money goes away, we don't have that source anymore.
Okay.
Maybe then we have one less classroom, you know,
makes good sense.
Yeah, I noticed we're almost back up to two classrooms for every grade again.
We're getting there. Yeah. We're getting there. And that's what, you know, school committee wants to be very careful about that, because we don't want to get ourselves in the situation Deerfield's in, where they're no longer accepting school choice in kindergarten in an effort to bring it from three sections to two.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, that's why I'm cautious with this additional classroom teacher for the current fourth grade. Right now we have 28 students, so two classes of 14. The natural inclination is to backfill it with school choice students because you've got the room. The only problem with that is, let's say over the summer, you have four resident That's students, and that happens in this town.
Right.
You're down to 24.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you've already created two classrooms. So you really have to watch it very, very carefully. 28 is high, but we have 29 currently in the sixth grade. So, you know, we have made it work.
Now you confuse me because I don't have an additional fourth grade teacher in here.
I know, but you have an additional first grade. It doesn't matter the grade. It's an additional
They start doing that.
Surprise.
Yeah. No, it's just one additional teacher. Okay. We currently have 11 sections, and we're going to go to 12. Going to 12.
Right.
Okay. Okay. Doesn't matter the grade.
That's how she's going to talk to me. Yeah.
Okay. And as I said at our meeting, our joint meeting, please don't chase the dollars.
Right.
No.
Right.
Right.
And again, you go down that wormhole, and I mean, you can look at Deerfield, and Deerfield did what every other community did.
Sure.
There was a goose that laid the golden egg, and they just wanted to collect the eggs, and that's fine. Except when you really step back and look at it, you have to say, now we don't want to make the same decisions.
Correct, because when I looked at those census, you have the census for school-age children, K through 12, in Sunderland for this year, a week ago, was 386 students. Last year, it was 333. The year before, it was 380. So you can't just look and say from last year to this year and say, oh, this is the incline that we're going to continue. It could go back down next year.
It's too variable. It's not a steady increase or a decrease. Right.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to jump to the frontier because I know we're tight in time.
Sure.
And I provided you with a little bit of narrative on pages 1 through 1 and 2. So I'm going to let you read those at your leisure, and I'm going to skip to page 3 where we talk about where we were at the end of this year and where we're going next year. So the net school budget that was assessed to the towns was $9,747,730. Again, we have the increase in our collective bargaining steps of $55,036. We have an increase in the amount we need for retirements of $102,040. Our total retirements are $186,000. We had $86,000 last year. This year we have $188,000, so that is why the increase.
Contribution to the system or?
Nope. Just this is teachers who are
retiring. Okay.
And their collective bargaining agreement allows them to buy back 2 days of sick time for every year of service.
Got it. Thank you.
We are looking at an increase in our psychological services of a 0.4 FTE, which would add $30,810 to the budget.
I just want to explain that because a position last year, an adjustment counselor, that person retired. That person was not replaced.
Okay.
So in an effort to meet the needs, we're not hiring back a full-time person, but a 0.4.
Just going for those hours.
So it still is a decrease, but we wanted to go through a year and see how that worked.
Yeah, okay.
And what's happening is the kids that we've been able to keep in district at the elementary level are now coming up to Frontier.
Sure.
So we need, the demand for the services is higher. We have a change of funding from the school choice budget of $126,934. That was money of positions we were able to fund through school choice. We no longer have school choice because our school charter out is eating it up. And I'll explain that a little bit further. Our tuition revolving account, we are going to be losing a tuition. But we're not going to be losing some people that were in that program, so we needed to add $38,496. The changes to the health insurance, the non-union and the union contracts is going to increase our budget by approximately $276,749. We do have a decrease in salaries due to attritions. We're estimating we can save about $63,237 between the people that are leaving and the people we could hire. Other operational increases, we need to now assess the charter tuitions in the amount of $69,788. We have an increase in our sped tuitions of $2,957,000 and an increase to our retirement benefits. And this, Scott, is our Franklin County contribution, increased $15,354. And here again, we're going to decrease our legal fees by about $8,500, giving us a net change of $646,427, or a 6.63% increase. So the amount that will be assessed to the towns is $10,394,157. Mm-hmm. That does not include your transportation assessment, and there is no more debt assessment. That is finished this year.
Do you guys have a bond burning in the backyard?
We old school? We got it burning in our minds. We talked about it, yeah, Scott.
Exactly right.
If you ever found your notes.
I sent them in. We'll talk.
Okay. Okay, so this next page, board 19, this shows us where we've been with our choice and charter. So unlike the towns who you pay the charter and choice out and the school gets the choice in money, the regional has to do both.
All right.
Okay? And the way that we've been doing it in the past, the way I inherited it, we should have been assessing the tuitions in our operating budget and then just using the tuition to fund positions. And we haven't done that before. Hmm. And I called the state on this to say, you know, this never happened. How am I supposed to be handling this? So apparently we've been handling it wrong. So this year we are going to have a net income of $48,929 at the end of, for 16, we have a net of 48. We had a beginning balance of 48, which leaves us $97,169 to spend. However, we budgeted $155,000, so we're short $57,916. We do have circuit breaker funds, and we are going to make, the school committee is going to allow me to move those salaries to the circuit breaker fund so that we end up even. But going into 17, you can see that according to the governor's budget, our projected state charter aid for the tuitions is going to decrease by $99,263. So we're still going to get choice tuition in the amount of $878,160 and then $51,504. So we'll have a total revenue of $929,664. Our outgoing school choice is $323,204, but our charter out is $676,248. So our total expenses are $999,452, which is a shortfall of $69,788. And that number you saw on the previous page, as well as the $126,934 that we were planning and funding in school choice, that had to get moved to the budget. Because those salaries of $155 this year are $126 projected for next year, and we need to have a source of funding, so they have to come back on the regular appropriated budget.
Tom?
Oh, I just have a huge fundamental problem with choice and charter right now.
I do too.
Well, to say, I mean, you can if you go to Montague and ask Montague, they would say that we're in an envious position.
Yes, for the first time though this year, the scales have been tipped, and I was explaining before the meeting began to Bruce that even though we have a 3-to-1 ratio, we are a desirable district. We have, for every one student that leaves, we have three who come in. The reimbursement that the state is not been fulfilling that particular formula, and the amount of money that is charged to us for a charter school tuition varies from school to school. And I think, you know, my true belief is that charter schools are looking to destroy public education, and we are the recipients of the good. So that's when I wrote last week to Senator Rosenberg, I said, if we are the recipients of the good,
right,
what does bad a bad look district like. Look like?
Exactly.
Right.
And how in the heck are we supposed to keep managing this?
I knew I could toss you a softball.
Sorry. It just gets my blood boiling. It just...
No, and I would say, and again, if you go to many schools, in Franklin County, mm-hmm. and in the area, they would look at Frontier as a gold standard. Let's say a gold standard.
It is.
And we're still, yeah, and we are. And the proof is in the numbers, except when you look at the dollars.
I know.
And see, that's, and I guess that's my only, my biggest concern. And again, when I talk about our elected statewide mm-hmm. representatives, I would love them to be here for the discussion. And not so much for our defense, but the defense of schools that are sending out that 3-to-1. How do they make
together?
It?
Yeah, a chart. And I sent the entire chart to Senator Rosenberg. I thought, here are real dollars with a real school system in real towns and real kids. So he wanted real examples because he's been going around eliciting opinions. Our school committee members have gone to some of his hearings that he's had locally. And I thought, here is real evidence of how it's impacting a very good public school system.
We're thinking, our Franklin County Selectmen Association is thinking we're hoping to have some person from this very high in the state come out on the political side.
Mm-hmm.
And I would love to have that information and
we'll
to
send
point
it to
and,
you.
And pointedly say, look, this is what we're seeing. If you're out in the trenches, this mm-hmm. is what you're seeing. So how can you know, you're preaching and the people that we're looking are telling us that school choice and charter are good things. I'd love to be able to, and they may be good things, but not when you're looking at the dollars that are being siphoned off from mm-hmm. the
right.
towns.
And look what, again, our competing districts who don't fare as well.
Right.
It is very troubling to watch what is happening to them.
We take a lot of children from Gil Montague. I said to Marty, how many kids are in Gil Montague that we have over 100 of them in our district?
Yeah.
And again, our board has been saying this since mm-hmm. December 17, 2005. And I remember the date, sorry, Lynn, but I remember that date specifically because I was told we have better things to do than on the Wednesday before Christmas than to be here talking about this. And to me, school choice has been, not school choice, but charter and school choice have been an issue
mm-hmm.
for a long time.
So yep. one of the other issues that I just want to bring to your attention was because I was told that my predecessor had not been, we should have had these the tuitions budgeted. Mm-hmm. I said, well, how do I allocate them? Do I allocate them based on how many kids go out from each town? Because Sunderland only has 6 kids.
Right.
And of those 6 kids, 7 of them go to what I feel are true charter schools, the Chinese Immersion and Performing Arts, and 1 goes to the Four Rivers. And she said, unfortunately not. It has to be towards the original agreement.
Huh.
It does.
Stay inside the
I would
form,
agree.
In the form
it
of
has
the
to stay within
and I would agree with that.
So, again,
it is unfortunate because right. there are other towns that send 3 times as many. And
that's not,
right. that's just
right.
what it
but
is.
But our union our regional agreement is our regional agreement.
It is
agreement.
Our regional agreement. Until it's amended, that's what we have.
Oh, so we pay
you pay
a bigger percentage.
We pay whatever, we pay a percentage of
overall
the total districts
right.
Right.
Yeah. based
right.
on our population.
Right.
Based
and,
on how many
and besides Waitley.
Right.
Waitley, who sends 4 kids.
Right.
So you send 8, they send 4, and the rest are from Deerfield and Cobb.
But that's never bothered me because I always felt that was when you're in a regional district, that's what it is.
Right.
And I know.
Agree, Mr. Fighting Character, I do agree. But I also think that after the superintendent retires, we really need to look at our regional agreement and really think about it because it has no way to assess capital projects. It's old, it's antiquated, and maybe we need to get a regional agreement commission together for us to look at that and see if there's improvements
yeah.
to be made.
Well, it's like anything else. You can't do something once and walk away from it and assume it's going to
right.
remain
and
the same.
And I think since 1956 and it's 2016, it's time to look at that again.
It's worked for Cuba.
Have fun with that one.
I was going to say something, but I don't.
Marty's doing negotiations and policy, so I promised her I'd wait until after she left.
Yeah.
Nice.
Okay, so then pages 5 again through.
These are the categories inside the operating budget.
Yes, are the detailed lines. And if you go, now usually at this point we do not look at assessments, but on page 17 and 19 we're going to look at them because...
You went all the way to 17?
All the way to 17.
Holy moly.
I made the font bigger, Tom, because I was tired of hearing people tell me, so I've got more pages, but you can read the numbers.
And the contrast is good. Thank you very much.
And the other thing is, we now have our chart of accounts aligned with the Department of Elementary and Education and UMass because we are a regional. Mm-hmm. So our budgets, our monthly reports, and our end-of-the-year report all look the same.
Nice.
So it's very readable and understandable.
Nice. Well, readable. It's understandable if you're really close to it.
Yeah. She didn't say agreeable, did she?
No, I didn't. No, not agreeable.
You purposely didn't say agreeable. Yeah. Ah, okay.
So with this proposed budget, Sunderland's combined assessment would go up $64,882 or 3.73%. And if you look at the next page, 18 and 19, there's the effect of the five-year enrollment. So if we look at Sunderland, you dropped out 145 and brought in 117. So you had a decrease, as well as Waitley. And Deerfield stayed exactly the same, and Conway had an increase. So when two have a decrease, one has an increase, that one that stays alone is going to take that hit too. So, but the other thing I do want to tell you is that after our last school committee meeting, they asked us to go away and, well, not go away. they
Freudian
asked us
had.
To go back and look at a few things, and we are working on that. Now, if that what they were asking us to look at,
see, I would retire if I was Marty too. I go out on a high point, right?
If we do what they've asked us to do, then your budget would actually decrease from your assessment would actually decrease from last year by $4,093, and you'd be down minus 2.4%. So this.
How are you going to do that?
They've asked us to go back and look at things.
No, there are some things. Remember when I talked about it in the beginning, there are a couple of things that we are taking a look at and that I am expecting a decrease most likely by the public hearing in March.
One of the things would be, you know, what could we use our E&D for? Mm-hmm. So because...
Oh, you haven't applied E&D.
Right.
Correct.
So because the retirements are a one-time thing, we might apply that to the E&D. As well as the fact that there's a few things that the district is in need of. We are, all five schools, we're in need of a new student information system. So we've asked them to consider doing that out of the E&D because that is the town's money instead of assessing the towns. So those are some of the recommendations. And the new student information system isn't even in the budget. It would then have to become probably a capital request because it does... require an initial outlay of cash because of training and getting our staff trained, but it would be cheaper than the one that we use now because they just have recurring fees and licenses every year. The new companies that are out there that we're looking at do it on a per student basis. So in the long run, we're going to have a better system and save money.
So flat license versus a kind of enrollment or subscribership. Nice.
So I can understand about the retirement being like a one-time expense. Last I looked, though, we kind of have people retiring almost every year.
Yes.
I think this is your last big boom year. Well, there's going to be a couple next year, but this year we have 7 or 8
and retiring. Some of them didn't get their notice in on time, so those get pushed to
the next year.
Yeah.
So I would look at what the average has been before you just take it all out and just.
I'm running a lot of data, Tom.
Yeah, because
years of service, age.
Yeah,
so you actually project that forward.
I'm doing that not just for Frontier. I'm doing that for all four elementary schools as well, that I can give even the elementary, the town administrator, sort of like a projection of what it's going to look like, because we may want to be coming to. coming to ask for capital requests to put it in your funds.
That was my question, because there's no reason why we shouldn't be able to at least make an assumption that here's our current labor force, and based on their ages and where they are, we should be able to at least make some kind of rough projection, because typically this has been a very up and down cost, and we've got like the sick time
buyout. The elementary school is stable now for a couple of years, and then you're going to see...
We'll hit another wave.
You'll hit another wave.
Yep. Okay. And at least if we can project out, we can look at it and know, okay.
The biggest problem with that, David, is that just like, you know, Yaz only played for one team, our teachers aren't like that. So I know what their service years are with us, but they might have 10 years somewhere else. So then I have to go, and because nothing is on, none of our staff is in, on computer, everything's in a file, then I have to go physically digging through the file and counting back their years at other school districts. Yeah. So it's a bigger project than I had anticipated.
So do you have HR staff?
That would be me. So
we don't have an HR.
Oh no, I would, and again, I would say, if the towns and the regional district would do anything, HR has always been a concern in our towns because that falls on our treasurer collector as well.
It's huge.
And that, so I would say if there's anything that we could do together, it'd be nice if the schools and the towns could do an HR.
We've been talking about it with our four town administrators meetings. We've been talking about that. We've been talking about technology. We've been talking about maintenance.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And I'm hoping some of those are the things and will be recommendations out of the long range study, because every single town is in the same situation.
We get killed with HR because there's, especially when we try to do HR with our elementary every September.
Right.
August, September.
In past June was the end of my first contract, when Marty and I renegotiated with the school committees, I have a new title. It's Director of Business Services, and part of that is that I'm taking on more of an HR role for Frontier, and hopefully, I'm looking at some softwares that would help us to do that. And if anything, we may, at some point, 2-3 years down the line, we may be able to help the towns with at least the school employees, and all that would be left on your treasurer's plate would be your municipal employees. So that's like our plan for right now, but how it's gonna play out with a new superintendent. And the last thing I would like to say to you is that I think you made an excellent choice in hiring Sherry. She has been a wonderful asset to our four town administrators already, and she is just excellent to work with. She's very responsive to our questions, and I've enjoyed working with her very much.
Thank you. Well, we'd like to thank that you participated in the We did ask the school administration to participate in the initial search also.
Right.
And we think it's important to have that back and forth communications.
Mm-hmm.
And we also enjoy the fact that we still have open communications, Marty, that goes back to you. And since you've been the superintendent, and one thing that we hope we don't miss is that we continue to have those meetings, because we've been asking that for many, many years, and it just started.
It's very, very important. We share an awful lot of information. People, as you know, different ideas come forth. I think they're vitally important. I think we're meeting again this week.
Thursday.
I don't know if you're going to meet I hope you're going to meet your replacement.
I met one of the candidates today. I will meet another candidate tomorrow.
And I would hope, if there's one pearl of wisdom that you'd pass on, is the communication with the town administrators for us as Board of Selectmen is critical, because we're not a town, and you know, and if you're like Greenfield or Hatfield or Hadley, the superintendent's going to talk directly to the town administrator or Board of Selectmen. You guys don't have to talk to us, but our town administrators need to know what happened, and that helps us.
Yeah, so I think it's been helpful for everybody.
So we appreciate that. And thank you for the kind words. We agree, but we can't say anything because we're going to have a evaluation. And all that kind of stuff.
Crazy talk. Scorecards at the door.
Okay. Thank you for having us.
Thanks so much.
Yes, thank you very much.
Questions before we break it up? Questions? Bruce shaking his head. You're typing away furiously.
If anything comes up, feel free to please email me.
Thank you. I do have a question. The sick leave buyback. Are the teachers sick? Is the teacher sick leave cumulative from year to year?
Yes.
So if they have 0 sick days cumulated, they still get their 2 days?
No.
No.
Okay,
they have to
so
have
it's
it
drawn
in the
from
bank.
The bank. Okay.
They have to have it in the bank.
There is a cap, right?
Okay. Up
a certain...
There's a cap, but...
But it's...
Is that years in the system?
Yes.
Or
yes.
Years in the total?
Years in our system. Okay.
Years in the system. So if you have a teacher who's been teaching for 30 years...
That's 60 days.
60 days
at their current daily rate.
Yes, I understand that.
That point has been mentioned by some people.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's something that would be very...
Other buybacks.
It would be something very difficult to negotiate out of a contract.
That's correct.
Yep. But...
He's on negotiations.
I'm well aware of all those issues.
What are we supposed to do, Frontier? Yeah.
March 3rd. Looking forward to it.
The other question I have.
Go ahead,
what,
Bruce.
What percentage sick? What percentage health insurance does Frontier pay?
We pay 80-20.
80-20. And that's dental insurance too?
80-20 for an HMO, 70-30 on a PPO.
Okay, and that's the same with dental insurance? They provide dental?
Yes, we do. We do provide dental.
Yeah. We do. That carries on to retirees, right?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
That was changed over the last two contracts. It used to be like 90%.
It used to be 90-10.
Yeah,
yeah. It was 90-10.
The dental insurance is the same no matter what.
Dental was added 2 negotiations ago, I think.
Yeah.
6, right.
So
the Franklin County, I have been a participant in the Franklin County, and I do have to say, even though the cost of health insurance is going up, in 5 years, we've had a less than 10%. No one else has seen that in the Commonwealth.
We've actually been lucky over the last seven.
We've been lucky. Yeah. But there are certain things I would like to see changed in how we offer things, because we can't control the cost of the insurance, but what we can control is our enrollments. So if there were certain things that would change that would discourage people taking our insurance and encourage them to go on to a spouse or take 2 single plans, I'm trying to work with them on that. They're also talking about increasing co-pays and everything else, but that would mean that every union in the Hampshire County Group Insurance Trust would have to approve those changes, and that would be very difficult.
Right. Good point.
And we do, in part of negotiations, we did write... we do have a pay, so if someone chooses to take their spouse's insurance, we give a one-time payout of $1,500
or an annual
payout. Yeah.
But it's still cheaper.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, by far.
This has been delightful.
Marty, thanks. You wait till town meeting and we roll the big cake out.
Hey, can I make a request?
Sure.
Can we not be in that little chain portion in the back?
Don't cage us in this year.
You have to talk to the town clerk.
We have to have a spot where...
That's fine.
But it doesn't have to be in the back. We'll work with it.
And even if it's on the bleachers, it was the chain around it.
Usually it's in the front.
Really? The police chief right by us like we were criminals.
Well, we were anticipating this presentation now.
It was just the chain. I don't care. A designated spot. It was the chain.
We promise we won't vote.
Or at least there's one part we can slip out.
That's right.
No, last year was the first time that we saw the chain.
Put them out there. And, we'll work on that, Marty.
There was only one way in and one way out. It was very... It was very awkward.
We'll fix it.
Okay.
Thanks
you
so much,
thank
everybody.
You. Have a good night.
All right. It's funny.
Thanks.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Okay, so we have...
Thank you.
Bye, Jason.
Minutes of February 8th are next for us.
Yeah, I'll make a motion on the minutes.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. 3-0. Okay. Comments about what we just saw before we go any further?
One of the questions I did ask, I was at the meet and greet with the potential new superintendent,
uh-huh.
And one of the questions I did ask this candidate was what she thought her biggest challenge with respect to the budget would be, because she comes from a vastly different, comes from New Hampshire, which is a very different structure. There is no such thing as choice or state money going into the schools. It's all from your property taxes in your town. So it's a very different...
That is interesting.
Paradigm in terms of how education is funded. So I kind of asked her, I said, what do you see as your biggest challenge coming in? Which is... She, for her, it was school choice because they don't have that.
Okay.
And while that's definitely an issue, I think when you step back and look at it, it's definitely not the biggest issue. It's one of them, but...
What we're seeing this year being assessed is formulas.
Right, exactly.
So I'm sure they have formulas in other locations, but this one here is a formula that seems to accumulate.
I think the state, my own opinion, the state creates formulas to make themselves feel good.
There's something about that. It'd be interesting to see what a decade of net school spending looks like.
Well, when you look at the budget, approximately 70% of the elementary budget is staff.
Right. It's right. Just a labor heavy.
Right. That raises a good point.
I didn't have time to do the Frontier budget, but I'm sure it's comparable.
Mm-hmm.
And for the state to say our net spending goes up $60,000 and their contribution goes up $3,000.
It's disproportionate.
I mean, there's
certainly worth bringing forward.
And again, sure. Whenever you try to make a formula or anything to be equal across one size fit all, it never works. Yeah. So
yeah, it's a good point.
Anyways,
even though that you're seeing the demographics here, get us a little bit. Board updates. You know, I've been here a little while longer than normal tonight, but board updates.
We alluded to negotiation meetings. We got another one of the nice 4-hour session coming up in a couple of days. And we've had some letters go out about our solar stuff, so we're keeping our fingers crossed there, and hopefully we'll get some good news out of that eventually. So,
Tom, you want to weigh in?
I think we, at the Board of Oversight for Senior Center, we were meeting tomorrow. I think we submitted the budget for them, right,
mm-hmm.
for the senior. And at the EMS, we have the budget created. I think it's the same as this past year, so we shouldn't see any changes. Did you get a copy of that yet?
Yes, today.
And that's the same as we had this year, so there's no changes in the budget. Sharon and I got to sit down there because there's certain things I need to know how we're going to have to present it at town meeting to discuss. So.
And those are the mechanisms, warrant article, frameworks, those kinds of, whatever the mechanisms
budget,
are.
Budget straightforward, but if we go to move from where we are now to Whiteley, what that process, mm-hmm. they'll be looking at having the biennial. It looks like it's time to replace an ambulance next year. So how we have monies available in our different accounts, how to get the monies out, payment of Deerfield for their clerical assistance last year. How do we put in this year's budget, or do you have? So I got to talk to Sherry about that.
Okay, makes good sense.
The fun stuff.
So it's
all the details and the stuff you got to do.
That's good.
The mechanics of it.
Right.
Yep.
I would add that we received notice last week that our housing production plan was approved. So that's good stuff.
Good.
Yeah. And now I thank folks in the housing committee as well as participants in some of the planning discussions, as well as Alyssa up at the COG for doing just yeoman's work. And Sherry came in toward the mid part of that process, and also was instrumental in making sure we get things moving forward. And that'll be that. Town administrator updates.
I'm going with the budget and revenue updates. Also, a thank you to STAM. They offered to send a letter in support of the MMA's recommendations with regard to raising the net metering cap in the SREC 2 program. So you have a copy of that. South County EMS will be here on the 7th to present their budget. And I wasn't sure, Tom, about scheduling the senior center. Do they usually come in? Or?
Whenever.
Okay.
Whatever you want.
And mowing bids were received today, and I'm putting that information together for you.
It sounds so spring-like.
I know.
Lawn care bids were received. Yes, bring on the robins.
And by the way, it's going to sleet tomorrow. Right, exactly. You know?
I didn't mean it wrong. Anything else, Sherry?
Yeah, that's it.
Okay, well, next up we've got appointment for a search committee for the police chief. There was a charge that was put out last week, and I'm wondering...
Any comments?
Oh, public comment? Hey, nice. Thanks for coming in, though. Appreciate it. Okay, so did we do something wrong?
No.
Excellent.
Right.
Okay, good. Thanks so much. We have to ask because there's a piece in our agenda that says public comment. Okay. Anyway, that
well,
goes for
and
you,
you
too.
And I didn't want you to have to wait until...
The very somebody, end.
Yeah, right. So... We just want to take
public comment from you.
Yeah, in terms of the budget, I mean, you know, when I joined the Finance Committee, how many, 10 years ago, it was kind of fun. And now it's like every year.
it's not grind. Fun anymore.
It's like, hopefully we don't need a dump truck or a police truck or something. I mean, it's crazy.
Yeah, there's a pressure, I think incremental pressure over the last 7-8 years, really.
Every time, yeah.
Well, that's one of the reasons why we've been putting a lot of pressure on the capital spend and the savings for that, for the separate
Sean,
override.
If you look at Frontier budget,
just, little
I don't know what the Deerfield, I don't know if the Deerfield Elementary was, but if you look at Frontier budget change for Deerfield and Conway, Conway is up, what, 113, right now is up 113,000, and which is 10.2. Deerfield's up 360,000.
Right.
Which is a 10.7% increase. You know, 360,000. I mean, our 64, that the 64,000.
It's proportionate, but if you look at it, but that's still, it's big.
Yeah, but as
how much is our revenue increase this year, Scott, by taxes?
About 168 to 172.
All right.
Total.
So if you look at Sunderland Elementary up, I mean Frontier's up 64,000. Elementary's up 214 right now. So that's let's say 270. Mm-hmm. Just putting those together, that far outweighs our ability to increase our taxes. Yeah, so you are absolutely right.
And we have almost two classrooms. All those kids are going to be going to Frontier, which is going to change our percentage. Great deal.
That mm-hmm. five-year drops off. Yes. You'll start seeing the number go up incrementally again.
And what we haven't seen yet is that we're having two tuition-based students go to Smith Vocational next year.
Right, which is cost of attendance plus transportation.
Transportation, yeah.
So you're and that's nothing else in the town. So you're absolutely right.
Everything would be better once the casino's up and running, right?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, that'll solve all our problems.
That's going to solve everything.
All right, absolutely, so right. You want to look at the chief of police?
Yeah, we could. Next up for us, and I appreciate the comments. Chief of Police Search Committee, we have, of course, a vacancy. We have a charge that was developed and a timeline that was developed. There are 11 folks, 11 residents who all put their names in. I think, first of all, thank you, everybody who wants to participate. It's a big deal. A screening committee is an interesting. It's interesting to be tasked to be on a screening committee. I say that because the environment in a screening committee can feel oftentimes a little canned. At the same time, it's very, very important that first look at any kind of applicant. Anybody who's hired knows the challenges. And in a municipal environment, there are a couple of other constraints associated with it. So the screening committee, you know, is a bit of an intimate look at the potential of a candidate, but it's only a recommendation to bring forward to the board. At the same time, it's an intimate look in the form of a pseudo interview process with resume reviews and some references. And there's a lot of things you can't ask. And so it's interesting. So people who have been on screening committees before tend to volunteer for them again. People who have done them and have never participated in them will also come back and say, I'm never doing that again. So anyway, I want to thank everybody. There were 11 folks who came forward. I'd like to talk, if I could, briefly about the structure of the committee. With 11 names, that's a bit it would make sense to have a couple of alternates. Mm-hmm. 11 is a big group. Even for a police chief, it's a big group. I think our very first, the very first thing I was involved in with town was a screening committee for the first town administrator, and there were seven of us. And of that seven, two, there were two available alternates who never had to be, had to be kept up to speed, but never had to be used. Everybody stayed with it. So the first order of business is the prerogative of the board for the size of the group. I'd like to have that out front.
Seven. Yeah, we were talking 5 to 7, somewhere in that range. So with the number here, yep. 7.
Yep. So we got 7 in front of it. There are 11 here in the pool. If we have 10. 7, we got 11. Maybe
you had 10. One withdrawal. Okay.
Oh, right. I'm sorry. You're right. Number eight. You're right. There was a withdrawal. My apologies. Yep. There is 10 here, 7, and then we could leave the remaining 3 names for alternates as opposed to it would make the most sense.
Mm-hmm. Fine.
Okay. Does anybody come? Now, we have a pretty diverse group in front of us. Dave, you want to read the names through just that we don't have the rest of it?
We have, pardon me if I mispronounce anybody's names. We have Laurie Salemi, Len Von Fladern, Aaron Wiley, Ed Chalik, Mike Wozniakiewicz, Stacy Meyer, Gary Breer, Bruce Bennett, Devin Melnick, and Alfred Albano. Okay.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to make the recommendation of Gary Breer, mm-hmm. and Gary Breer is also the chair. I'd like to appoint him as the chair of that committee just because of his long involvements with the town and many different things.
Okay. No. There was initially a potential where he was out of state for a short piece in March.
Yeah, one
as long meeting. As it doesn't prove to be a conflict.
Right.
Okay.
I also like to recommend Leonard Von Fladern, who is I think retired as a major, is in the state police, State Police, yeah. And Mike Wozniakiewicz, who was a former Deerfield chief and lifelong resident of the town of Sunderland.
Okay. Anyone else, Tom or Dave, you want to weigh in?
Let's see. Yep. How many does that get us up to now? 4?
That's a quantity of 3 right now.
3?
Yeah. Let's see. We got a sitting finance committee member.
Yep. I'm trying to spread it out and as much as we can.
Yep. Good point.
We have one finance committee member on?
Yeah, right now there's one finance committee member.
Yep, Bruce.
I'd also like to make a recommendation of Laurie Salem, Aaron Wiley, and Stacy Meyer.
So you got Laurie Salem. Did you want to put Bruce in, Dave?
And
Bruce?
Yeah. Yeah, we should have somebody in there.
Stacy Meyer?
Yep.
Okay, so what I'm hearing is Laurie Salemi, Len Van Fladern, Mike Wozniakiewicz,
Aaron Wiley.
Oh, I missed Aaron Wiley. Yep, Aaron Wiley.
Mike Wozniakiewicz.
Yep, Stacy Meyer,
Gary Breer,
and Bruce
Bennett.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and the remainder can be alternates.
Ed Chalik and Devin Melnick as alternates. Yep. Okay, that works.
Okay, you capture that all right? Yes. We went down the list, up the list, started in the middle, went back up, came back down again. So again, Laurie Salemi, Len Von Fladeren, Aaron Wiley, Mike Wozniakiewicz, Stacy Meyer, Gary Breer, and recommend him as the chair, and Bruce Bennett in ready reserve, Ed Chalik, Devin Melnick, and Alfred Albano. Okay, if we can get the packets together, the office, is there a motion to appoint as a screening committee as discussed?
Not a motion.
Motion's made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please. Okay, so those folks, I want to thank, again, everybody for volunteering. And more importantly, those folks can check in. You got to get sworn in.
Right.
You got to check into the town office building, get sworn in by the town clerk. It's a short charge. We're looking for mid-April. And again, I recognize schedules. We all recognize schedules. It could go, a little longer. That said, there's going to be information packets that will be put forward. And the very first meeting will be with the town administrator about the do's and don'ts of screening. So yes. Listen to the don'ts.
That's right. Those are the important ones.
Really important. Okay. We have a charge here for the 300th committee, 300th celebration committee, and that's a pretty good sized working group right now, but I think the charge was an important piece of framework to bring forward. And Tom, is there any questions with regard to the charge?
No.
Okay, is there a motion to accept the charge or adopt the charge as of this date?
Motion. Second.
Motion's made and seconded, so we're going to adopt the Sunderland 300th anniversary committee charge, and those folks who are involved in that, please again come in, pick this up. We'll motion's made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3-0. I tag that as adopted today. And there's an amended line there that's really, really important because it is a working committee, and I'm sure something is going to change. We can certainly amend
the
charge.
No question about that.
Okay.
So would you like to formalize the committee and make appointments at your next meeting?
I would think we have not next, but the one after.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. We are Saturday the 27th, which actually is this Saturday, Representative Kulik's going to be at the Sunderland Town Library here talking about renewable energies, timely with respect to the SREC.
I'll be there, yeah.
SREC, as well as net metering discussion and the cap. I can say that in the open marketplace, there's a fair amount of tension right now, and a lot of that work is kind of stalled as we wait to see what comes of this all. And then we're on next Monday back here, same bat channel, same bat time.
That's right. Just look for the signal in the sky.
Yeah, you're right. Okay, any other comments or questions? If not, is there a motion to adjourn?
Motion.
Second.
We have a motion made and seconded to adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, you can call us out at 8:16. Thanks so much, Lacey, for the fine handiwork back there. Staffing the controls, making us look good.